Greetings all. If you don't know me, I'm Nicholas Moran. I go by the Chieftain, and I have come to Arsenalen to do some filming. But while here, Stefan has invited me to show up on your channel, and we decided we're going to talk a little bit about UN vehicles. And we're going to do probably, I guess, a little series of videos on vehicles that the Swedes used in UN operations. And the reason I asked to do this is because I don't think this is a subject that gets a lot of attention. Certainly in America, people think the UN, they just go around wearing blue berets with rifles and they're not allowed to do anything and they just get shot at and they don't do very much. And then they'll pull up examples like in Bosnia when the Dutch stood by and did very little because they weren't allowed to. But the reality isn't like that. There's some of the UN missions are full combat and you need armor. So Sweden has been involved in UN missions more or less from the start.
Yeah.
So, well, where do you want to start then?
We could start with Congo.
Congo, okay.
1960.
That's more or less where the Irish start as well, actually.
Yeah, 60 to 64. Yeah.
And there's actually been a long tradition of the Irish and the Swedish working together.
Yeah, for some reason I don't really know why it happened, but we have been together. Different missions, yes.
Both are neutral countries, so perhaps that has something to do with it.
Could be. Trust. Do people trust them? I don't know.
Okay,
you are,
well,
you're Irish?
I am.
And I'm
Swedish. American. People wonder, am I Irish? Am I American? I'm, my dad's Irish, my mom's Greek, and I'm an American by birth. So it's confusing. But okay, let's start off with the Congo, with a Congo vehicle.
Yes.
Right, so this was the first armored vehicle that Sweden took off on its UN missions, correct?
As far as I know, yes.
All right, it's ugly. What is it?
Ugly, yes.
Other than ugly.
Yes, it's ugly. It's an armored APC developed during the Second World War for being a troop transporter for the armored units.
Okay.
Instead of having the infantry walking together with the tanks, they developed this. And it's called KP-bil, which is armored protecting vehicle.
Okay, how did this get to the Congo?
When we went to Congo in 1960 for the UN mission, there were a lot of, they realized this is gonna be a bit problematic with enemies, etc. So they chose this one to be part of that UN mission, and they send a couple of armored cars armed with machine guns on the top. Mm-hmm. This one is the earlier one, so it doesn't have the machine guns mounted on it. And they were using them as sort of scout car, patrol cars, also to transport units to the posting and then
bring them back again,
etc. So they were.
Did you fly them over or did you send them in a ship?
I suppose they were sent by ship. I'm not sure. But it could be that they have flied them over. I'm not sure.
Yeah. So when the Irish went over, they there's pictures of them using American airplanes.
Could be the same. And they were working together with the Irish. So they were using them together in the different operations. Yeah.
The Congo, though, doesn't strike me as being a country with great roads. And this looks like basically a road truck that just has a metal body around it.
Yeah, but as far as we have heard from the people who were there, they loved these cars and they were really, really something that helped them. And not much talking about getting stuck, etc.
So it's all-wheel drive? Yes.
Yeah, it is. The problems that they had with them was that on the top, the machine gun was not protected.
Okay.
And that was something that they realized quite soon, that we have to make an armor protection around the machine gun. They had casualties with snipers taking out the machine gun.
So the Irish had their, we call it, you know, it's a come to Jesus moment in the Niemba ambush, when they realized that the equipment that they were bringing just was not suitable for modern conflict. It was all still World War II issue stuff. Did Sweden have a similar defining moment in its UN missions?
I'm not so sure about that. They brought, they had their submachine guns, automatic rifles. They had Carl Gustav anti-tank, bigger machine guns. So they were quite well equipped when they were there. But I cannot tell if when they got there first, they realized, oh shit, this is gonna be a big mess, so yeah, we need more equipment. So they probably brought in quite quickly more and more, depending on what they saw.
Yeah. So the Irish have Niamba, they have Jadoville, they have the Battle of the Tunnel. Were there any major Swedish engagements?
Yes, there were, and we were there during 4 years, from 60 to 64, and they are, I'm not sure how many, but several conflicts, Katanga base, air base, for instance. So they had quite a lot of battle experience, and they also did a famous film about one battle with the air support of the Swedish aircraft Tunnan, which they used as air support.
This is a Swedish movie?
Yes, and it was filmed after the battle.
Mm-hmm.
So they redid the battle once again with everything so they could film from both directions. And I've spoken to the guy who did the film, and it was hilarious.
Can we find it on Amazon or anything? Or
is... I'm not sure if it's, it should be out somewhere.
Well, what's the name of it? I'm sure your Swedish audience will want to watch this now, if they didn't,
we
if they even know it's on
out
there.
And we will
put a little subtitle at the bottom. Yes. So if you speak Swedish at least, you'll be
there
sorted.
There are pictures everywhere about this, with where you see, I think, two or three of these from the front, and then you have the aircrafts coming towards them. So there are a lot of footage about this. So they were used a lot, and they really loved them. And then they brought some of them to Middle East and Cyprus, and some of them they were left in Congo, so they're probably still there. So they have also been used in other places later on, which is something that's really impressive to have. This vehicle have been used a lot in UN missions.
Yeah. Especially for something designed in 1942. It's canvas. Okay.
Yes.
So you just sit on the side and shoot out with your rifle that way.
Yeah. So it's open top. Later in Sweden in the 1980s, we rebuilt them with armored roof.
In the 1980s.
In the 1980s.
When did this go out of service?
2000.
So 58 years.
Yeah.
Ouch.
Ouch. Yes. With still the same original engine and manual gearbox.
Who manufactured the chassis?
We had two. Scania made this one, and Volvo made another one. And the Volvo went out of service a bit earlier due to it wasn't that reliable, so they kept the Scania for another 40 years.
So this seems to be a common thing. You will have a vehicle which meets the same specifications, you give it the same name, but mechanically it is entirely different.
Yeah.
Doesn't that cause problems for the maintenance guys?
Sometimes, yes. Well, you had the same with the Sherman.
True, but we got rid of that after 5 years. I mean, looking at the M42 to the 74 and so on, you know, change after change after change.
Yeah. But I suppose they had them in the different units, so that will not be that big, but logistically, yes.
I mean, training the mechanics would be an issue. I mean, how often, if you join a unit in the Swedish Army, do you stay in that unit for your career as much as possible, or is it like the Americans that they swap you around here and there?
You often stay normally. Well, you move around a bit, but normally you will stay. And the guys who used them in Swedish Army, they were the conscripts, so they were only trained on that and nothing else.
So the guys that went to Congo, were they selected? Were they volunteers?
They were volunteers.
But they could have been conscripts who volunteered to go overseas.
Yes. They were, all of them, except for the officers, they were volunteers, conscript soldiers. So they're different age.
Was there...
So there were no professional soldiers from the Swedish in the UN in Congo, except for the officers.
So when the Swedes came back, so certainly the Irish was, it was almost a national embarrassment, the Irish surrendered at Jadotville, or they got their asses kicked at Niembe or whatever. So the Irish army sort of had not a great reputation immediately afterwards. Did Sweden have the same problem, or was it just, hey, we did well?
The problem when they got home from Congo was that no one took care of them. Mm-hmm. It was a conflict far away. Not so many cared about what happened there. And the people who went there said that they were sort of left alone, didn't get much attention from Sweden. So mm-hmm. they had to sort of solve the problem. And then when they got home, it was, hey, goodbye. And
good luck.
Yeah.
Was so that Sweden's first major conflict in, or first major combat in quite a long time?
It was the first where they went into combat. Yeah. We had been earlier in 1956 in the Gaza region, but that was not that much. Mm-hmm. So they went from Gaza to Congo with a few units to be the first on.
And before that, the last major fighting that the Swedes did?
1813. Official one.
When did neutrality become policy?
Good question. First World War?
Fair
probably.
Enough.
Probably.
All right, well, let's move on to, I guess, the next vehicle.
Yeah.
This looks familiar. M8 armored car. I didn't know Sweden bought any.
We didn't.
Explain.
When in Congo, the sort of enemy, it was difficult to tell who the enemy actually were in Congo in the conflict. The people engaging the Swedish troops in Congo had M8 armored cars.
Okay.
That the Swedish took out.
Mm-hmm.
And then went and collected them. So they collected four of them. And realized, we could use them because they have a gun.
Yeah.
So they sort of restored what's necessary and make them running again, painted them in whatever color they could find at the place. So this is something that came up there when they were there. They used different buckets of paint and just found out the color scheme.
Anything except pink.
So, yeah, except pink, yes. And they had the gun, and they also mounted different machine guns on the top, whatever they could get hold of. So they had.
So they weren't necessarily Swedish machine guns.
It could be others, depending on what they had and the ammunition. The problem was for the gun.
Yeah, 37 millimeter isn't in the Swedish supply system.
No, not the same as that one. Different, and they found a few rounds that were the same they thought, but it didn't fit.
Didn't fit. Okay.
So they had, as far as I know, they had one original for each, just in case. And I've spoken to one of the drivers who went to the local workshop they had in the base camp, and he grinded the round to make it fit. And when he did this with his explosive rounds, the rest of the workshop, it went empty and said, you're on your own doing this. I'm not sure how many they managed to do, but they grinded off to make them fit. And if you think of, someone would do that today, would that be allowed? In a UN mission, 2000, and
I think
maybe you are going home sacked for the rest of your life.
Well, that's an interesting question. It's sort of how desperate are you? Because there's always lots of history of people taking whatever they can find. Like in North Africa in World War II, the British realized that the 75mm shells were not working against the pattern. Oh, look, there's German 75mm shells. And if you take the projectile from the German shell and you tweak a little bit the cartridge case for the American shell, you can get it all to fit, and then you can fire the German ammunition out of the American. Mm. It was officially approved.
Yeah, and it's fully understandable because they were desperate. Yeah. And as the driver said, well, what's the option?
Yeah, and
be killed here tonight with this or tomorrow?
Because you don't have the ammunition. And the other thing, I guess, is you're not worried about really high velocity armor piercing. So there's a good canister round for the 37. It's like a shotgun. Mm-hmm. That's probably not hard to make if you have the primer and the powder. Mm-hmm. So I could see that being wise. I guess the other thing worth mentioning is you mentioned the enemy, which you don't usually talk about on a peacekeeping mission. Congo was peace enforcing,
yeah,
which is a different policy to a lot of missions.
So they actually had an enemy that they were engaging, that was probably a very big debate at the time, what was happening there and who is on which side, etc. So that was a big conflict, since we had sort of two sides fighting each mm-hmm. other.
Yeah, so you mentioned that you just found, well, basically captured the four vehicles.
Yeah.
We had the same thing in Ireland. There was an M113 that showed up. Nobody's entirely sure where the M113 came from. And then at the end of the conflict, the M113 went away, and there's like a couple of photographs that prove that the Irish had the M113s. So not an unusual concept there.
And the Swedes also had, I'm not sure of the number, maybe it was two or four M113 that they also used for some period, but I don't know where they came from, but maybe they were on loan from someone.
There's this magical M113 depot in the middle of Africa.
And these vehicles, they were named, on the side you have four different names, and this one is represent all four of
all
them.
Four
so
of them.
They all had four different names.
Ambel, Lulubel, BB-bel, and Nina-bel.
From the crew members' girlfriends.
What, all three crewmen had the same girlfriend, Annabelle?
Some, maybe the commander had, it's my girlfriend, or the driver. I'm not sure. And on the turret, they were a bit young men, so they painted the conflicts where they have been. You have on the rock concert.
Yeah. Do you name your tanks in the Swedish Army? Do you give them names?
More or less. It's not a standard, but the crews often do. Depends on which unit and when, etc. So, from time to time, yes.
What was your tank's name?
We had one that was called Lama Patte.
Which translates as?
It's the nipples on a small sheep.
And I don't know, you named your tank that?
I didn't do it. It was the crew who did it, because our platoon leader was from the south of Sweden, and he used different kind of expressions, so they just took that for fun.
I don't even know where to go on from that one. I'm sorry.
So it could be anything. It could be.
So it was lamb. So it's not even sheep tits. It was just lamb nipples.
Yeah.
What, these Swedes are strange people. Okay. So the M8, you use them in Congo, and you left them behind.
Yeah.
What didn't you bring any home? Just as a souvenir. I mean, I presume the soldiers would bring back souvenirs, captured weapons or whatever.
Yeah, they brought home small souvenirs, which they captured, the flags, etc. But I think since they also left the Swedish armored car, a lot of them, mm-hmm. it was too much trouble to bring it back at the time. So probably it wasn't any chance to do it. We also had one M3. Scout car, mm-hmm. used as good to have vehicle.
It's armored, it's fast, it's wheeled. So with these engagements, or are they actually engagements or just assignments? Is there any record of these things being used in action?
I think these were all where they did something more like battle. KP-bil is probably the most famous, where they had a lot of battle. KP-bil base.
Okay, well, I mean, I like the M8, but I kind of wish I could own one. I can't afford it.
Nice car.
All right, let's see what else we've got.
If you like these films, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.